Okay, lightning round time. So we're gonna go through some of our native shrubs, and I'm gonna tell you how to identify them without leaves. The first one here is speckled alder. Take note of this sort of reddish, coppery colored bark with these white speckles on it. Alders in the birch family. Every species of tree in the birch family has these things. They're called catkins. In the case of speckled alder, these things are gonna be red. If you grab their twigs, what you'll see are these pretty bulbous, sort of burgundy colored buds. I learned that the bud on the end of the twig looks like a boxing glove. So it'll be a small tree, usually not more than 3 inches in diameter, and usually not more than about 15 feet tall, growing in these dense clumps with lots of small stems. The last thing to note about speckled alder, this one doesn't have it, but I'll put in a picture of it, is that sometimes it can look like they have these cones, almost like these woody little pine cones dangling from the tree. The next one that we're gonna look at is witch hazel. Witch hazel, a lot of cool stuff about it, a lot of wildlife benefits. I also really struggle with it because it's a species that deer don't like to browse. In areas of my land that have been browsed very heavily by deer, the understory is a monoculture of pure witch hazel. Witch hazel in Vermont usually grows as basically a shrub. I mean, it can be 10 feet tall and maybe an inch and a half or 2 inches in diameter. I know in the southern part of its range, though, it can actually get a lot bigger. But here it's just basically a multi-stem shrub. So you're usually gonna see witch hazel as these sort of clumps of smaller stems. Like speckled alder, witch hazel has what are called naked buds. So that just means the bud isn't encased in scales. And I learned this one as winged foot buds. So I know I'm gonna mess this up, but that metaphor is from the Greek god Hermes, I think, who had these feet with wings on them, right? And so this is the foot, and this is the wing that's attached to that foot. Here's another example of that. So there are these little things that almost look like flowers. What it actually is sort of the base of that floral bud. When they flower, they have these flowers that are yellow, and it's these long, long, ridiculous looking yellow petals. They also have a really cool seed holder. I don't have one on this plant, but I'll put a picture of one up that looks like a hot cross bun. And what that is a propulsion device where that can dry out more and more and more and more and build up so much pressure that finally it'll fail explosively and shoot this tiny seed way out into the woods. So here's another one. This one's purple elderberry. Purple elderberry at its tallest will probably be like 6 or 8 feet tall. Again, growing as a shrub, so they'll usually be like multiple stems coming out of one little clump. What you can really see clearly here is how warty it is. In a way, its bark is speckled, like speckled alder or witch hazel. But those speckles are actually raised, and it makes it sort of lumpy and warty. The other thing to notice about elderberry is that it's really pithy, so it actually has a really different wood quality than these other species. It just feels almost like squishy, like hollow. It's almost as if you're eating like a crab leg or a lobster leg or something like that. It's like this hard exterior, but then just this really pithy, squishy inside. Elderberry, like maple and ash, is opposite branch. So that means that buds and twigs come off branches and twigs opposite one another, in this case at this perfect 45 degree angle. The other thing you notice about purple elderberry are these big fat purple buds. I mean, look at these things. This one is one of my very favorite shrubs. It's called beaked hazelnut, and in Vermont it's our native hazelnut. Beaked hazelnut buds are brown and they're scaled and they're covered in these fine silvery hairs. And I learned them as bunny tail buds, powder puff buds, just because of all those fine little hairs. Sometimes they can be really, really fuzzy, especially on the tip. Like speckled alder, they're a birch, and so they have catkins. These catkins are like half an inch long though, way shorter. It might be hard to portray here, but one thing that I've always really liked about beaked hazelnut is this pattern that they have on their bark. Similar to witch hazel, their bark is a light brown and speckled with these white specks, but it also has these dark brown sort of tendrils that form this really cool pattern on its bark. Beaked hazelnut will be even smaller than these other species that we've talked about. Usually it's gonna max out at like 6 feet tall. And if you see a stem that's bigger than like a half an inch in diameter, it's a really big one. Okay, so the last one is staghorn sumac. Staghorn sumac is an oddball and should be easy to tell from all these other ones. It's really a small tree, more than a shrub. Usually you're gonna see them 10 feet tall or less, and probably 2 inches in diameter or less. Staghorn sumac to me looks like a creepy, hairy, like spider leg. Usually by this single stem that's sort of this like reddish, yellowish brown color with all of these fine hairs all over it. It has these yellow buds that are like recessed into the stem and another one of those yellow buds on the tip. Most people think of sumac as being pretty invasive because it easily invades yards and open areas and hedgerows and places like that, but it's actually native and indigenous people actually use them as sap spouts where they would cut a piece of sumac, hollow out the pith and stick it in the slit in a sugar maple tree. The other thing that I don't have here, but I'll put a picture in of, is that staghorn sumac will hold on to these clusters of these red, fuzzy berries that can be very, very distinctive.